Thank you. And now I invite all the speakers here on the stage. Please come up and sit down here. But at the beginning of the discussion, will be started with a short presentation by Professor Coleman. Then we'll go to questions and comments from the audience to individual presenters.
Thank you, you are very kind. I was struck by something that the EU Health Commissioner, Tonio Borge, said today, not on the 25th, but the 26th of November. I quote from his talk earlier today, EU goals include control plans in all member states, reducing cancer incidence by 15% by 2020, and bringing together cancer registries across the European Union. And he was referring at that point to the European Cancer Information System being developed or developed at ISPRA. And what I wanted to do was to recognize that there is an elephant in the room in relation to cancer registration and confidentiality. I was going to mention Eurocare, but as I mentioned earlier, that is about to be published, and I don't propose to present any information from Eurocare. But if we look at a wider context of surveillance, the global surveillance of cancer survival, we're currently putting together data from over 250 cancer registries, of which 119 are in Europe. 70 countries worldwide are contributing, and almost half of them are in Europe, 29 in Europe, 23 in the European Union. And that is a map of the European jurisdictions with cancer registries that are contributing. There are some prominent gaps there. Sweden is one of them because of legal problems which have not yet been resolved. Belarus is another gap, but actually that has been filled in the last day or so. And the reason I'm pointing this out to you, and the green areas on the map here are those for which data have already been received. So practically all of the European areas that are registered to participate in survival surveillance have already provided their data. But there is a problem, the elephant. And it is the European Union's data protection regulation, which is currently at a very late stage of development. It has been through almost all its stages in the European Union, and it is striking that with the exception of a few remarks from Ahti Antila and Milena Sant during today's presentations, almost no mention has been made of what this regulation is going to do. If it is passed in its present form without change to the key articles, which I won't go through here, it will not be possible to do cancer registration. It will be either illegal or impossible. And data concerning health can only be processed for research with the consent of the data subject on every occasion. That would have to be written, informed, rescindable consent. And the Federation of European Academies of Medicine has made clear that if that is so, if it is passed in its present form, all research would require consent, biobanks and registries would become impossible, and it would have devastating consequences for health research. And the key issue here is consent. It would produce unquantifiable losses of information in cancer registry data. There's a long list there. I won't take up your time. But I want to make clear that the legislators in the European Union need to learn a message of history. There is no effective cancer registry in the world that operates with informed consent. When it was tried in West Germany in the 1990s, the existing cancer registries, including Hamburg, which was the longest standing cancer registry in Europe since 1929, collapsed because they could not register enough cases. The East German registry, going since 1953, closed. Hungary introduced a similar law, its registries closed. There was a 7 to 10 year gap before those registries could come online again with various changes in the law. And that is what is going to happen across the European Union, all 28 member states, when they implement the regulation, because it will become statute law immediately it's passed in every member state. And that is going to be sometime next year or possibly 2015. There is only one solution, and that is the Commission, excuse me, the European Council needs to take action during the trilogue negotiations in order to modify this regulation. This is a quote from almost 15 years ago from a medical journalist who says, "I don't expect patients just to tolerate the kind of work that registries do. I believe they would be astonished if it weren't done." This is a message that you need to send to your legislators in the European Parliament. When this partnership launched in September 2009, the organizers very kindly asked me to talk. And this is one of the things I said. It's very long, but the key bit is, if the European Union is serious about cancer control, the European directive should be revised now. That was the directive on data transfer, so that population-based surveillance can flourish in all member states. That was because the directive was heterogeneously implemented across Europe. It has now been replaced, or is about to be replaced, by this new European regulation, which, as I've said, will become statute law in every member state. The only thing that I would change 4 years after those remarks is to make it the EU regulation. In 4 years, we have made no progress in ensuring that the European laws permit and indeed encourage cancer registration. That is the elephant in the room. All of the talks today, all of the ministerial speeches, would be impossible to make after this regulation is passed. It needs to be changed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So now we'll go to the discussion on the national cancer plans. So I will take questions from and comments from the audience. Yes, can you give the microphone to the lady back there? Okay, sorry, to the gentleman.
Thanks. My name is Francesco De Lorenzo, President of the European Cancer Patient Coalition. I think that the decision to have a guidelines for cancer plan is very welcome. It's very important for cancer patients. And I think that would be nice to know from you if within the indicators, are you considering also rehabilitation? Rehabilitation now is really an important need. It's a new need for cancer patients. Very few cancer plans. I didn't find any of them that were just concerning about rehabilitation, as well as the follow-up for cancer survivors. And the last thing I would like to do is, if we can export the best practice, then we should get the French cancer plan. Thank you.
Yes, I think that you targeted the point that is of course of my personal interest and of the commitment also of the future joint action, but nevertheless, given the question to the as to the guidelines, rehabilitation is going to be a part of the guides for cancer plans. Rehabilitation is a major issue. We are in many ways lagging behind some other chronic diseases that have a longer tradition in long-term management, like cardiovascular diseases and diabetes and so on, because we have to admit that there are other issues apart from survival. I'm happy that Professor Coleman stressed survival, but given the survival, we have now people, and we heard the numbers per country, there are hundreds of thousands per country living with cancer, or they have beaten cancer, fortunately. So now what happens? There is continued care. It's not only oncological, it's other care, it's social care, it's a reintegration to work, to social life. All these aspects have to be covered. We will try to select indicators, and of course, as we are going to in the next two rounds of consultations with partners, that means also patients. Yola from Europa Colon reminded me that I haven't stressed patients. Of course, patients are partners of EPAC, and they will be consulted on the guide as much as anyone else in the finalization. And we will jointly seek to develop the indicators that will best reflect the level at which rehabilitation is carried out at all the dimensions that I mentioned. Thank you very much for this question. Yes.
If you don't mind, I would like to add something on indicators. You're right, we have written all our plans with strong indicators. It's a problem to define an indicator and the target of the indicator at the beginning of the plan. If you are too ambitious, then everyone looks forward at the end of the plan and say you didn't reach anything, and it's not you're not good enough in following the plan. And if you're not ambitious enough, there is no dynamic. So the target has really to be closely thought before with all the actors. It's the main problem for us now to define the target, for example, what we want to reach in tobacco control, in the diminution of, in the decrease of incidence, or in the number of patients who should return to work after cancer. It's a very difficult task.
Okay, we have a question back there, yes.
It's Yola from Europa Colon. My question is to Agnes Buzyn. Hi. I have two questions. One is, your 28 centers, are they only able to deal with molecular testing, or are they also used for other laboratory use? And my second question is, you had a very, very impressive economic model showing the saving for lung cancer by EGFR testing. Do you have the same for colorectal? Thank
you. I will answer the second question. This calculation has been done for all the tests, and it's moreover always beneficial to the healthcare system. Sometimes it's less impressive than what I've shown, but it's always in favor of testing due to the cost of target therapies for patients. Even if you use it for only 3 months because it doesn't work, it's 3 months of a very expensive treatment. For the other question, all these molecular platforms have different histories. Some of them are pathologist labs. Some others are cytology labs. In fact, all the structures we have organized in the plan are identified after a call for project. So it means that we do not decide at the beginning how it should be. The plan is a top-down initiative, but the way we select the teams is a bottom-up on call for proposals. So there is not only one type of structure.
Yes, a question here.
Luzia Travado from Lisbon, Portugal. Having participated since EPAC, before EPAC in 2006 in the preparation of the cancer into the EU health agenda from the part of the Portuguese European Union presidency, I've seen that we have gone a long way. In that cancer roundtable in Portugal that we held in 2007, there was a new item. We discussed national cancer plans and, of course, the need to all European cancer countries having national cancer plans as the best way to achieve good cancer control and care. And we have gone a long way, including other items as psychosocial care and rehabilitation, which were not before in the plan, and Francesco De Lorenzo has mentioned this area, and I would like to emphasize the psychosocial dimension apart from the biological side of rehabilitation as in the WHO definition. We, in fact, I was also part of the Euroship program on cancer rehabilitation indicators, and there is already a proposal concerning those indicators which can be used for the present purposes. And so I would just like to compliment the working group on national cancer plans from IPAC for putting this new template or guide for national countries to really focus and re-update their plans to include these different dimensions. I would like to mention that in the psychosocial oncology actions that I lead under WP7, we have done a mapping of psychosocial resources in European countries, and we have seen that 20 of the 27 countries that have cancer plans already include psychosocial care into their cancer plans. However, when we asked if there is a budget for allocating its implementation, only 10 out of those 20 did refer that they have a budget. So there is still a lot to do from the wishful list, which the National Cancer Plan, in fact, is, to the delivery of care. So I would like to comment on this, to put some of this element in the guide, because it's not only a recommendation, but also recommendation to have specific budget to specific areas. Otherwise, they will stay in the shelf. So thank you very much. I would also like to comment on the recent plan of the Poland, because I was impressed by such a good new plan, including all the dimensions, and that's an effort that we should compliment. So my congratulations to Poland. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Maybe meanwhile, may I put a question to the presenters? I find the inclusion of the primary care of the GP is quite an obstacle. How do you deal with this? How do you try to deal with this? Maybe from here, yes.
The question is to me. Okay, I'm sorry, I wasn't sure. It was already planned in the previous plan to put the general practitioner at the middle of the pathway of the patients. And it was really a disaster. It didn't work at all. So that's the reason why it's coming back. Now we have some tools. We have, now it's mandatory, what we call the dossier communicant en cancerologie. It's a web file for patients, which can be implemented by hospital professionals, but which is can be used also by the general practitioner. We also decided to organize the pathway of patients from the diagnosis to the comeback at home with the general practitioner in several steps. And it will be in the next plan. There will be help by nurses for this this work by kind of platforms of medical and social workers to help general practitioners to offer social resources to the patients. So we will try to organize medical social platforms, not in the hospital, but really for help to general practitioners for their general practice with cancer patients, so they can call the platform for help with cancer patients.
There's a question there in the front.
Yes, name is Kathy Apostolidis, and I am the Vice President of ECPC, the European Cancer Patient Coalition. I have listened carefully to the cancer plans, but my question is, where is survivorship? Survivors now are reaching 25 million in the US and some 11 to 12 million in Europe. What is going to happen? What I see now in the countries in Southeastern Europe that are ridden by the financial crisis are that survivors are completely forgotten. We are cut off from cancer care. All regular cancer tests that we were taking have been cut. Nothing has happened. We do not have access to oncology care because they are having patients who have active disease. So what is your thoughts about it? How are you going to tackle the issue?
Maybe all could try to answer this question.
Well, I'm sorry to answer again. I feel quite, I'm sorry to speak so much, but we have this problem, of course, in France. That's the reason why this issue was pointed out by the French president as a main issue. We have 3 million survivors, and we have to take into account their problems. And for example, that is also about the general practitioner. We will add in the pathway of care what we call a consultation of ending, where all the transfer of the main informations and the follow-up of the patients will be transferred to the general practitioner with formal tools. So that the general practitioners can be really part of the follow-up. This is one way of answering to your question. And of course, we are working on a lot of social problems about insurance, work, etc. It will be a main axis of the plan.
Yeah, I think in our societies there has been more and more focus on survivorship, and so I somewhat disagree with you. I was, and in our national strategy in Norway, this focus on survivorship, on late side effects, to include this into the treatment guidelines together with all the rehabilitation, together with the treatment of the patient, is now a natural part of it. So I think to include this into the guidelines, what system should we have to pick up the problems survivors really do realize? The general practitioner's role in this aspect is important, but some of the patients should also have to see other experts, but the focus is extremely important, I agree. We also have a national resource center for late side effects dealing with this, trying to improve the competence of the healthcare providers in the country. I agree with you that we should have a focus on it, but I think we have now there is an increased focus on it in our country, and I hope that's the situation in other countries as well.
Thank you. As back there again.
It's okay. I'd like to show off for the UK for a change. I spend my whole life congratulating the French. So in this case, I'd like to say that Michel, you might be able to help me out here. But in the UK, the cancer czar, Professor Sir Mike Richards, has actually moved from his post and is currently involved in setting up with Macmillan, which is one of our big patient organizations, a survivor patient pathway. There is a lot of work being done to pilot what is needed, what is missing, and how best to put it into place. So maybe for once the British can teach the French something.
J'en serais pas convaincu. You're right, there is developmental work going on with the survivorship pathway or pathway for survivors. Mike Richards, who was a very effective and long-standing national cancer director, as you know, I'm sure, has moved on from his post to higher things. But we still do have a national clinical director for cancer who is a practicing gynecologist, a gynecological oncologist, a surgeon, whom I've met only once, but who clearly takes the importance of what you have just said very seriously and will, I'm sure, give his attention to ensuring that the patient pathway after diagnosis is improved. And there is also training being developed, as you again probably know, but training being developed for primary care or general practitioners to ensure that they detect not only symptoms suggestive of a malignancy earlier, for earlier diagnosis, but also problems that relate to post-cancer treatment care more promptly so that they can be handled more efficiently. And that is part of the survivorship pathway that you're describing.
Yes. Any more questions? Yes.
Thank you. My question is somewhat related to the problem of survivorship, but to the aspects of survivorship, and an aspect that is not present in many of the cancer plans and in many of the programs that you are presenting today is the palliative care. So I think that maybe in some plans for survival, for controlling the all the course of the disease after diagnosis, like survivorship, the theme of the palliative care is present, but today it was not present in any case. Are there specific points in the cancer plans that have been presented today for palliative care, which is a very important problem, especially in southern European countries, I think?
Well, I think in our country we are concerned about the doctors and their skills in palliative care, also the oncologists, in fact. I mean, we are not very much concerned about the nurses and other healthcare providers. They are so focused on the palliative aspects of the treatment, but the doctors, to train the doctors, we have a national or Nordic training of doctors in various specialties. We don't have a specialization for palliative care doctors by itself, but it's an addition to other specialties, 1 year of education. And I think that's the main concern, and that is the involvement of the doctors treating the patient in this field. Palliative care is extremely important, and if you are an oncologist, you are not necessarily a good palliative doctor. That's my point of view as an oncologist.
A small comment, I did not emphasize it because based on the fact that unfortunately Italy was not the best player in this field, the Italian Parliament has adopted a specific law on palliative care, not only for cancer, for all diseases in 2010. And we are still on the way because this law is, as many other things in Italy, are rather complicated, so it forces a lot of government tax in order to implement it. However, I must say that there has been a small revolution in Italy based on after the adoption of this law, and there is now all regions are creating a sort of network of specific services, partly based on the hospitals, partly on private and non-profit organization. However, there are several things going on, so it's not in the cancer plan explicitly, because there is this specific planning based on a specific law at the national level.
Thank you. Yes. Yes, please.
Yes, Rosemary Alcel Park from Department of Health in Paris. I just wanted to add a small remark on the palliative care. We have in France a plan for pain and for palliative care, and there's a link between the national cancer plan and the national plan for pain and palliative care, and there will be a link between the two to improve treatment of pain and palliative care for the cancer patients.
Thank you. Yes, back again. Then the second one.
As perhaps you remember, the 208 Council conclusions were just inviting member states to work together to develop an European cancer plan. I wonder whether you have some ideas to give a suggestion to the Commission to have at least to overcome the enormous inequalities being present now in Europe, to work together with towards a minimum guarantee in the European cancer plan. This would be for cancer patients a very important tool.
Yes, well, I decided to skip a few slides that were relating to the recommendations that we are going to make related to the guide. One is that, and we discussed this with the representative of the Commission, Antoni Montserrat, that when the Commission makes an implementation report on EPAC, it will also have to designate how this continued work on the guide and monitoring of cancer plans is going to be performed. We can undertake it as a part of as a task within the next joint action, but looking more forward, of course, as we try to do so, we would like to see this task being a continued one. And I think that this will be followed and will be dealt with in the next spring. So this is one thing, one part of your question. The second part, which is even more important, the inequalities. The inequalities are an important problem, and I think that they were part of all the presentations of all the cancer plans that we have seen today, and that they are a very serious problem, and that they are an important priority. However, I will make two remarks. One is that even a report that was prepared for the UK presidency in 2005, where Professor Malkenbach from Rotterdam analyzed the socioeconomic differences across all EU and EEA states, showed that even Norway, which we all know is one of the least socially disparate countries in Europe, showed a gradient similar to one that Michelle Coleman showed, so that the less privileged in the society are lagging behind the improvements. They are improving, but they are improving less. So this is one of the problems. One of the challenges for cancer care is the fact that, of course, there is unfortunately a convergence in prices for what we all have to pay. The GDP gradient within the EU is 17 to 1, I would like to remind you, between Bulgaria and Luxembourg. And the price gradient for medicines, on average, is 3 to 1. So that is the stress undergone by the countries that are that have a lower level of economic development. This has its reflection, unfortunately, also on cancer care. I'm not saying that cancer care depends only on investment, but we have seen that it depends quite a lot on investment. A topic to be picked up also on the next joint action.
Yes, another comment?
There is also a threefold gradient in all-cause mortality between countries in the European Union, which is correlated with the gross domestic product too, as well as being reflected in the excess hazard of death, or if you will, the differences in cancer survival. And I hope I didn't indicate that survival was the only indicator. I pointed out that it was one of the very important metrics needed to assess progress in cancer control. But when we're dealing with inequalities in outcome or in access to treatment, at the risk of sounding like a broken record, I would like to make it clear that if the European Union wants a European cancer plan, or the Commission wants a European cancer plan, then it is, I think, worth remarking just how extraordinary it is to have that wish, but not to ensure that the instruments that provide the information to inform that policy will remain in existence. If you want a European cancer plan, for heaven's sake, change the regulation to ensure that cancer registries acquire a derogation from the requirement for informed consent to receive population-based information. Otherwise, in 1 year or two, you will not know whether there are inequalities in cancer occurrence or cancer outcome. For some politicians, that could perhaps be a welcome news, but generally, I think they would like to know. And so they need to ensure that registries can survive the regulation that is currently going through the European Parliament.
Thank you. The question there, yes, Beck.
I'm Anna Wagstaff, and I work with Cancer World magazine, and I'm also talking about information in cancer plans. But I'm talking about information about what is actually happening on the ground, because I think it's brilliant, since I've started working, how much progress has been made on getting countries to take up the idea of cancer plans and the idea of indicators and doing all that sort of stuff. But I worry that there is going to be a big gap between the intention and what's happening on the ground, and that is very, very rarely available and documented. And so journalists who could be really on your side here and pointing out where there are inequalities in access and what actually is going on, get very little access to information. Certainly in the UK, I think it's true that health is probably the area of public spending that is the least transparent of all, even though it's the most important for all of us. It's virtually impossible to know what's going on. If we find out, we find out about 3 years later, by which time they turn around and say, oh yes, that was a problem, but we've fixed it now. And therefore, there's a real problem in accountability. So what I'd like to know is, in terms of these guidelines of cancer plans, are you trying to address as well issues of performance monitoring, of audit, of patient-related outcome monitoring, of trying to find out in real time whether the things you're saying in the guidelines and the treatment and the care pathways and so on are actually happening in a form that people can make use of, rather than it always being anonymized so that you can, you know, say, oh, well, there is this inequality, there is this problem, but you never know where it is. You don't know who's performing well and who's performing badly. And quite frankly, if you don't know that, then there's very little pressure on anybody to change. So there's a transparency thing that I'm interested here.
Thank you. So shall we go from this side or from that side? Start, yes.
Anna, you mentioned inequalities in funding. That is not something about which I know anything. But since funding clearly relates to outcome, I think it's probably worth recognizing that increasingly geographic and socioeconomic and indeed ethnic inequalities in outcome are being measured more effectively, not just in the UK, but elsewhere across the European Union.
Some more comments from the panel?
So this is not strictly related to cancer. I don't know if it's with your question, but there has been a recent very polemic in Italy because the government has supported with the National Healthcare Agency over the last 5 years an extensive study on the performance of several different diseases indicators, and this data have been recently published, and the intention was not to spread it really to the public, but due to the ordinary misleading behaviors, there were several newspapers having published the results before the actual publication was made available, and that was an half disaster because I think, at least in Italy, we're still on the way that we have serious methodological problems in order to clearly use outcome results in order to measure the performance of individual providers. I guess this is the path for the future, and I think at the end of the day, patients should be made informed about exactly where they are going, what happens when they are treated. However, I think we are not yet the technical tools in order to make it in a scientific way. We are on the right way to have it, but I think we are not right. It's not the moment now to use it immediately. I understand the issue of transparency, but the worst thing that you can do for transparency is to publish bad results or results that should be interpreted by people which are skilled and can understand the methodological issues that are behind. Clearly, I understand that there is a problem here, that we have data that are or should be theoretically in the public domain and that are not used. So this is also something that is not acceptable. I think that the relatively good compromise is to invest more in research and correct publication of this data, however, still to publish it with several caveats, making patients and citizens aware that these data, if they are not put in an appropriate scenario, might be misleading. That does not mean that this data should not be used by policymakers, in particular by managers, because these data are significant. In particular, you might understand that we in Italy we have this paradoxical issue that most of the investments, most of the all the money is spent in the regions that have, as an average, the lower quality of healthcare. Clearly, this does not mean anything on individual treatment of individual patients, but means something in terms of policy making and planning. So this kind of reflection should be more extensive and more strongly used at the political level, and progressively we should extend the information also to citizens, but avoiding that they have to decide on their own where they can be treated or elsewhere, because I think this is still something that could be even dangerous.
Professor Dwight, yes. Yeah.
Do we really implement the cancer plan? So do we monitor implementation, and do we monitor the results of it? I think from my point of view, what's happening in rectal cancer in some of our countries really, I think, put light onto these questions, because to establish a quality register should, of course, be national, but a quality register telling the surgeons or the doctors what the results they really have on local recurrence rate, survival, and so on. What happened was that the hospitals with high
local recurrence rate or and a low survival, they stopped doing the surgery. So the number of hospitals in our country doing rectal cancer surgery was reduced from 60 to 25 hospitals because of poor results. So that's an important thing. And today, these results are open for the public on the internet. I think the results from this is using the quality registries in this respect would be very, very important. There's one thing that hasn't been discussed here, but I think that's a major point, and I hope it is being discussed in the cancer plans, although not discussed here, is the cancer surgery. In general, because surgery is still the most important factor for the curative treatment of patients, and it, as I said earlier, it's a question of volumes, it's a question of robustness of different aspects here. But do we have a focus on cancer surgery, standardization of surgery, indications for surgery, over-treatment of prostate cancer, for example? Have we these discussions? Because I'm not very much concerned about chemotherapy. I think we really are modern, and we do as good as we can, and there's strong forces for chemotherapy in our societies. But surgery, nobody talks about much about surgery. I really hope that we in our cancer plans take cancer surgery, really put more focus on cancer surgery in our countries and in Europe across the borders.
I think these clinical registries, as you mentioned, should be a very important part of the cancer plans for this quality control. That's the answer. I think that's the answer to your concern. Yes, another comment I think there was from the... Then we have the question here in front. Yes, please.
Thank you, Chair. Jose Marti Moreno from Valencia, Spain. I wanted to contain myself because I would like to make many comments. I was listening and learning. And actually, the last comment by Dr. Steinkas, in reality, yes, we are considering in the guides, we are considering very carefully, not only obviously medical oncology, let's say, and radiotherapy, but also surgical oncology, which is very important, and also immunotherapy and psycho-oncology and all the other aspects of integrated care. But my point, the fact of taking the floor, dear Chairman, is just not to avoid to take the challenge that Michelle Coleman put on the table. Because in reality, it could be understood by, you know, politicians, or this is a group where we are already converted, right? We believe in cancer registries, friends. So we don't need to convert ourselves. But at the same time, it is true that we need to convey the message in the best possible way. First of all, that we support the revision of data protection regulation and the objective to preserve personal privacy, the right to confidentiality, sensitive personal data. We are with social media, Facebook, and so on and so forth, and this needs to be regulated. But actually, this is absolutely compatible, this personal data protection and access to patient data for purposes of cancer registries and research should be preserved. And it's a question of actually applying common sense to the legislation regulating this access to data. With proper safeguards put in place. And there is no reason that patients should feel that their privacy is threatened. And this is absolutely essential. So we must work for the perspective of balance, responsibility, and common sense, so the personal data are protected, and at the same time, cancer resistance and research and data and transparency and accountability are made possible for the benefit of the citizens in Europe and so on. And basically, to finish this, I think we speak a lot about advocacy. We speak about advocacy. And the more, the older I get, I'm becoming, you know, a heart donor without frontiers. It's a new NGO. Okay, the older I get, the more important I believe that we also need to be even activists. So not only advocates, but activists. I would think that the take-home message, because we had tried, I was also in the European Parliament. I was speaking with Aloyd Peterle, a wonderful champion. Unfortunately, he's not here. With Sean Kelly about the data protection. They were very sensitive in the European Parliament about our case. I am really surprised about the stubbornness that we proposed, ECHO proposed, ESMO proposed, all the scientific societies proposed amendments in order to ensure that cancer risks were preserved. But still, the threat is there. The only way is to come back to our countries and to speak with our ministries and explain very clearly, you know, we respect, obviously, data protection, but please apply common sense and make it possible to defend, you know, cancer control, prevention, for the benefit of the European citizens. Thank you.
Maybe I correct you, not take home message, but take to the European Parliament message.
Screening also, not only research and cancer registries, but also the screening programs, which are essential. If you don't have the data, you cannot invite and you cannot evaluate.
Exactly.
Thank you so much, yes. Rosemary. Just one thing. When I say take-home message or here, is because obviously the Parliament seems like far away. We are not going to go together to, you know, to make a demonstration. But when we go home, you know, the European Union is not people who are there. It's our countries. It's our member states. It's us. It's not something has to be done. It's we need to do something. It's slightly different. It's not somebody has to do something. It's let's do something together. It's our ministers who should understand that we are here to protect health and who should listen to us and who should go to the European Council of Ministers saying, stop it. No way, Jose. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. A short comment.
I think it should be no way, Jose Maria. Jose Maria, thank you for those remarks. For those of you who don't know, Jose Maria was formerly a chief medical officer in Spain as well as the deputy director of WHO Euro in Copenhagen. So when you hear someone with that pedigree talking about becoming an activist in the European Parliament, you know that this is an issue that has to be taken seriously. It is true that all of the steps have been taken except one, and that is in the European Council, where health ministers have status. So it is no longer a question of talking to your MEP. If he's not on your, he or she is not on your side already, the battle is lost. The question is to approach in whatever way possible your Minister of Health, who will be the person or his or her delegate will be the person taking the decision in the European Council. That is where it needs to be made clear that cancer registry, a derogation from informed consent for disease registries, not just cancer registries, but disease registries, needs to be inserted on the face, that is, on the document of the European regulation. It does not appear there at the present time. That is what is needed, and it needs to be done soon, because the negotiations, the trilogue negotiations, may well take place in the next 3 to 4 months. Thank you, Jose Maria.
Yes, another question in front there.
I wonder whether the ministers of health do really have power, since they are working for the ministers of finance. They do not have real power. They submit their budgets to the ministers of finance and they decide on what needs to be done in healthcare. So.
You may be right, but it is health ministers that have the power of decision on this issue. Let me tell you something. The European Union committed 1 billion euros to the Innovative Medicine Initiative over 7 years. That is to support pharmaceutical industry in developing drugs, an important thing to do, I do not deny. If they gave that kind of money to support the information systems that every health minister needs to monitor progress, that I have calculated earlier today would represent 1 million euros a year for 7 years for every cancer registry in Europe. And there are registries that do not have the resources even
to complete registration of patients or follow-up of patients for survival. How on earth can we get that kind of disparity in funding from the European Union for cancer control? I do not understand it. We need to talk to health ministers and make sure they understand it.
Do not have a powerful lobbying.
Okay, thank you. Yes, another question there, please.
Yes, Job Seiler from Malta. Can I just pick up the point about the surgery, the cancer surgery, which is very much the most important part of treatment? I'm really going to cause more problems here, but the problem is that the cancer registries are too crude. They do not reflect accurately enough the quality of surgical care. For example, and I'm speaking as a surgeon here, but for example, the recurrence rate, I think a recurrence should be a notifiable incident in the registry. And if you look at many cancers now, such as breast, the vast majority survive. A one-year death rate has that gives no reflection of the quality of surgical care. 15% recurrence rate after so many 5 years does reflect surgical quality. So I think there are problems ahead. I think the cancer registries have to record more information, not less, especially in countries which are already good at that. And this is something which one should tackle if you really want to look ahead and improve the quality of cancer care.
You are right in most respects. I speak both as a doctor and a former cancer registry director, one of the largest in Europe, the Thames Cancer Registry. The problem is not so much the cancer registries recording the quality of cancer care, it is that there is no system that is internationally comparable for recording the actual procedure, never mind the quality of the procedure. I speak as someone who's just completed an international study looking at survival by stage and as a function of treatment. I mentioned it very briefly during my talk earlier today. Even the quality of stage data is very difficult to get harmonized internationally, and the treatment data, it is currently almost impossible. Trust me, I've tried it on millions of cancer patients. It's not that the registries do not wish to record it, it is that it is not recorded reliably and completely and comparably across hospitals or between countries of the European Union. If that were done, if there were an international agreement for the nature of procedure, how to code it, and what quality was achieved in its performance, then it would certainly be much easier. And the linkage of cancer registries to the kind of clinical audit systems to which several people have made reference earlier today is already proceeding in many countries to improve the quality and completeness of the clinical data that cancer registries record.
Okay. Sorry, before we take the last question, I'm really sorry, but we have some time constraints. Let me just give a point. I really was astonished by the data in the Polish NCCP. They have a yearly report to the Parliament. That would be very welcome for us and have a very big impact. I think that's important. So please, the last question back there.
I have not a question, but just a practical help to the problem arising from the information we received from Michel Coleman. So just to inform, I'm the representative, the delegate of the Italian Cancer Network, Alleanza Contro Cancro, and also the director of the organization of the European Cancer Institute. Together with the European Cancer Patient Coalition, we are organizing a debate at the European Parliament on February 18. You will be informed about this event on how uniform is cancer care in Europe. So representative of the European Parliament, the OECD, and from the European Agency for Health and Consumers, president of the ECPC, the president of the OECI, will debate about the problem of the inequalities in cancer care in Europe that are strictly related to the cancer control. So this is a practical help. We are inside the parliament, and there will be one of the places where to support the need of do something to give the possibility to the cancer registry to work better and better in the future. So, thank you.
Thank you. I have to conclude this. Maybe my impression as the chair, we have to fight with these inequalities, and NCCPs will do the job, but we'll have to upgrade the registries in order to go in the way from the Norway information. We have to upgrade our registries to deal with these inequalities, not to abolish them, as was pointed out. So that would be my conclusion. But before you leave, I have to give you some information. There is a dinner today at 8 o'clock here in this room. That's why we have to conclude at this time. Those of you that are not registered, there is still time. There's no problem. Just find some of the conference organizers. So have a nice evening, and I hope you enjoy the session.